Hey everybody, welcome. This is our rap session. My name is Jeff.
I'm Jodianne.
My name is Brian.
And today we're going to talk about a very important subject. But before we do that, I want to go ahead and read this Bible verse that we have here on the screen. It's 2 Corinthians 4, verse 3 and verse 4. It says, "But if our gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost, and whom the who?
God of this world.
The God of this world hath blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them." So when we look at this verse, what I understand from it is that Satan, as the God of this world, he is trying and doing calculated efforts to try to dim our understanding of the character of Jesus Christ, right? So if Satan is doing this, trying to dim our understanding of the principles of God and the things of God, where would Satan start?
Children.
Children, okay. Mm-hmm. Brian?
In the home, media, education systems like schools.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Satan will begin with the children and even at home. You see, that's why today we're talking about this very important subject is here on the screen, deception, fiction, and our childhood cartoons. Why are we talking about this? I mean, most of us in our generation, some of our favorite pastimes when we were kids was what? Watching cartoons. For me at least, watching cartoons. Even today, I don't know about you guys, even today when, not today, but in the past, when I would be at my old church, our friends would get together after church, and then someone would just start singing, "Pokemon!"
Oh, boy.
And then everyone is singing together. Mm-hmm. We're singing it together because there's so much nostalgia, you know, when it comes to the song. There's so much that we carry with us even to adulthood, mm-hmm. right? So that's what's very interesting. And can you guys remember any shows that you loved back then when you were kids?
Yeah, that's what I was trying to remember before.
Right.
So like SpongeBob, Pinky Dinky Doo. Not many people know that one.
I've never heard that.
It's kind of more educational.
Okay, yeah.
Pinky and the Brain, Looney Tunes, shows like that.
Yep.
Ooh, Teen Titans.
Teen Titans. There are a couple of shows, but how many of us here, you know, do you guys remember the show called Blue's Clues?
Of course, yes.
Blue's Clues, right. Yes. So Blue's Clues, if you remember Blue's Clues, what do we remember from it, right? You have a little blue dog and you have a guy, Steve, and every time what would happen? Steve will be missing a glue stick or missing his scissors, and Blue, what instead of telling him where they are, he'll give him clues to try to find it, right?
Mm-hmm.
So let's look at a clip from Blue's Clues that aired around this current generation, recently, right? So let's watch this video here.
Hey, Blue, look at all these families.
Hi, families.
It's time for a pride parade.
Families marching one by one, hurrah, hurrah. Families marching one by one, hurrah, hurrah. This family has two mommies. They love each other so proudly, and they all go marching in the big parade. Families marching two by two, hurrah, hurrah. Families marching two by two, hurrah, hurrah. This family has two daddies. They love each other so proudly, and they all go marching in the big parade. Come on, friends!
Kids today, your kids, watching television, whatever they might be watching on these popular syndicated television channels, right? And these shows. Your kids, our nieces, nephews, are watching shows that are made for kids. Yet, what did Satan put into the show?
Wow.
This is a pride parade, a gay parade. Even the person singing, that is a transgender man.
Yeah.
It's a drag queen,
wow.
Right? Now, do you guys remember anything like this?
Oh, absolutely
clues?
Not.
No, I don't.
No.
Not at all, mm-hmm. Right? So, quick question. What are your thoughts on it, first of all?
Well, I think they're definitely, it's definitely more extreme with the gender they're pushing, especially upon those children. It reminds me of the scripture, and we spoke about it just now, you know, start at the children. It says, raise up a child in the way that he should go. When he groweth old, he shall not depart from it. Mm-hmm. So it seems like they're trying to bring this upon the children to accept this lifestyle or to walk in that way. Mm-hmm. So they're raising up a generation to be more focused on this type of lifestyle.
Because we got to understand that kids are like a blank slate.
Yeah.
So whatever you download into them, that's their normal. That's what they believe is right. That's true. That's what... So they're programming them from now to create a generation that this is normalized. I mean, they put it to a really rhythmic song that's really catchy.
Very catchy, very
catchy. When they said two moms and two, that was it.
When I saw this, I was like, I gotta show you guys this. Yeah. This is crazy.
They're so bold.
Yeah, and it also reminds me of what the Bible says in Revelation 18 and verse 23. It says that the light of the candle, of a candle shall not shine in you no more. And it's talking about Babylon, and it's talking about the world today, right?
Right.
But at the very end, it says, by the abundance of your, by thy sorcery were all nations deceived, right? So by the sorcery of the devil, the sorcery of Babylon, the sorcery of all the merchants of the world, as it speaks about in Revelation chapter 18, verse 23, the merchants of the world, by their sorceries, by Babylon's sorceries, were all nations deceived. And how or where does Satan start once again?
Yeah.
In the home, at adolescence, at childhood. So just a quick question, this is for us. Do kids need to learn about different LGBTQ families?
Nope.
Brian, what are your thoughts?
Personally, I think so. Okay. And the reason why I say that is an interesting one. And I'm going to open my Bible to Luke 17.
Luke 17.
And verse 28. And this is speaking about the end. And it says, likewise also, as it was in the days of Lot, they did eat, they drank, they bought, they sold, they planted, and they built it. So the reason why I say yes, to show children or to show others, what this is a sign of, even a sign of the end days, how the world is waxing cold and sin is increasing. So in that sense, yes, I do believe we should use it to show the time we're living in, and even how Christ likened it to the times of Lot.
So he said teach them. So I was interpreting that they can be aware of it, right, as you said, to agree with Brian, so they can know that this is not right, this is not biblical, God. You know, but to teach them, like, break it down into the different... Oh, no. Yep. That's, right.
Yeah, and I believe it's better for the parent to let to teach the child or let the child know about these things before letting the world teach the child,
right.
Oh, hey, this is good, this is acceptable, right? Train a child in the way that they should go, right? And they shall not, depart from it, right? No, it's crazy. So, should parents leave television and entertainment to teach their kids about the world? I mean, it's a very simple answer, but let us get your thoughts.
So I have Deuteronomy 6, verse 6-7 that says, and these words which I command thee this day shall be in thine heart, and thou shalt teach them diligently unto thy children, and shalt talk of them when thou sittest in thine house, and when thou walkest by the way, and when thou liest down, and when thou risest up. So this is what we're supposed to be teaching children.
Mm-hmm.
So what was the question again?
So should parents leave television and entertainment?
Right, so leaving television, especially in this day and age, either without vetting it or without vetting it. So even if you watch a car, because my mom used to watch Blue's Clues with me, but if there was supposed to be a younger child today that still continued to watch Blue's Clues, we have to understand that these cartoons are evolving with the time. The creators behind the cartoons are different than, well, probably not different, but they're more bold with their lifestyle.
They have an agenda.
Exactly.
Right.
So TV should not be the parent of the child. And a lot of parents use it as pastimes to get what they're done, to get what they want to get done, and then leave their kids there not knowing what they're digesting.
Absolutely. Brian, any thoughts?
It reminds me, firstly, TV, for the most part, it's not leading people in the right direction, because obviously it's not God-fearing entertainment or media, I should say, or education, in other words. And it reminds me of Psalms 101, where it says, when the psalmist says, I shall set no wicked thing before mine eyes. So if we truly have the fear of God, we would not be watching such things on TV, and much more not allowing the children to be watching such things. And it's like what Sister Jodi Ann said, many parents, and even me growing up, my parents, they would give me some money or put on something on TV and send me on my way so they could do whatever they want to do. So people use it in a way to keep the children entertained or away, or so they could get a break. But by doing this, they're setting a wicked example, and they're allowing these children to be educated and by this media that is being portrayed to them. And they themselves are not doing the job of a parent to educate them in the right way.
Just a last point, and it allows the parents to neglect their parental duty, because the home should be the first school of a child. Whatever they learn there is their foundation. So like Jesus, God chose Mary specifically because of how she would educate him on the principles of God and not the rabbis and the synagogue. So the parents' role is neglected, and then they leave them to be educated by these other people.
All right, so you know what? I would like to say that this was the worst, but it's not, unfortunately. So I have another video that we're gonna watch, and let's just get your reactions, all right?
There you are. You missed our royal ball.
We met the most amazing princess, but they ran away, and all they left behind was this.
Everyone, there's something I need to tell you. The princess who came to your ball tonight was me. I'm Gonzarella.
But Gonzo, why didn't Vu tell us?
Because you all expected me to look a certain way. I don't want you to be upset with me, but I don't want to do things just because that's the way they've always been done either. I want to be me.
Oh, Gonzo. We're sorry. It wasn't very nice of us to tell you what to wear to our ball.
You're our friend, and we love you any way you are.
Yeah, of course we do.
Yeah.
Well, first of all, what effect does something like this have on children growing up?
So, cartoons are very influential because of the characters that they use and the voice animation. So if you realize, they use innocent creatures, like little animals, little cute things, and the voices behind them are so innocent, and it relates to the kids. So I did find an article that says that cartoons are one of the effective means that use colors to communicate something.
Really? Like in the psychology fact, of it all, right?
Colored moving images first capture children's attention before they understand any message, providing them with a world full of symbols that reflect complex concepts to explain to a young child. So, as you can see, they're pushing, again, the gay agenda, but they use things that children will find so innocent, and they put emotion into it, like, oh, you didn't have to be ashamed, we'll love you just the same. And it's damaging to the kids, because they'll now feel like, oh yeah, it's okay, they'll love me the same. And if someone doesn't love you when you do come out, it creates mental problems. And if you do like medical studies on this, LGBT communities have a lot of mental issues that they have to deal with.
That's true.
And depression, isolation, all of that.
And it normalizes cross-dressing with children and young boys to say, hey, I want to be a princess. Hey, I want to be like a woman today, right? Or say, hey, mom, I am a woman. Or a young lady saying, hey, I am a boy. And imagine young kids watching this as they grow up. They're so desensitized to this kind of programming that all of this is normal. So when a Christian comes with the word and saying, hey, a man is a man and a woman is a woman, only a man and a woman should be together, they say, hey, what are you talking about? That's not right, right? Because since they were a child, they were programmed. And I just want to say this one thing, that if we look at the Garden of Eden, when the serpent approached Eve, right? Mm-hmm. In the spirit of prophecy, it says that the serpent was very beautiful, very mm-hmm. colorful, right? Mm-hmm. And that Satan used the serpent as a medium to go and speak to Eve. So Satan will come to us in beauty and attractive words, right? And indoctrinate us with whatever he wants us
to. Yeah, and you could say that Eve was first captured by how he looked. She wasn't really listening, but it was how he looked. So it's the same as the cartoons. Right. The message goes over your head.
Right. Any thoughts, Brian?
I agree. We are told in Jeremiah that the heart is desperately wicked, very deceptive. So many think that they're following their heart or being themselves, when in reality, many lack the understanding that that they are actually following the inclinations of sin, because, you know, sin dwells in their flesh. We're born in sinful flesh, and they don't understand that, hey, this is not whom God has called you to be, but you're just following the path even of destruction. And as you know, it goes all back to education, like you were saying. And it reminds me of another text. In Proverbs 23, it says, as a man thinketh, so is he. Mm-hmm. So by putting these thoughts or these ideas in the children's mind, they're raising up them to be like that. And that's why we as Christians, even for our children, we should be teaching them the right way. Even as the psalmist said, thy word have I hid in my heart, that I might not sin against thee. So we're hiding the word in our heart, and teaching the children to do so also, they will not follow this path, and they will see it as a shame. Even as the cartoon said, he said, I was ashamed, I don't want them. And he should be ashamed, it's a sin. Right.
Some shame is good. Some shame is good, I agree.
Yep.
Anything else?
That's about it, yeah.
Okay, all right, no problem. So just this question, because we know that, we see this on the show, right? Mm-hmm. And we know that today we have a lot of young people, we hear in the news, young people and parents saying that their child identifies as the opposite sex, right? So should a parent accept that their child wants to be the opposite sex? Tough question.
I think that for me as a parent, if I had children, I would not allow it in my home, because again, the home in the Bible is even likened to the church of God. There's a similitude. You go to 1 Timothy 3:15, likens the house to the church of God. So the next question is, would we allow these type of lifestyles or heresies or false doctrines or apostasies in the house of God, as a God-fearing preacher or man or woman of God? And the clear answer is no, we don't allow this. And the same should be applied for our individual homes, because again, the church is made up of homes. So if every family is allowing this, what will they allow into the actual church now? So it has to begin in the home, as it says in the spirit of prophecy, that the heart of the community is in the home. So I would say, no, I would not allow it in my home. I would not accept it for my children. Now, if they grow old and they want to move out and do that, hey, that's on them. I'll keep doing my part, praying for them, trying to sow seeds. And I pray that they'll become even as a prodigal son, that they may return back unto the home and unto a true relationship with God.
Yeah. Any thoughts, Jodian?
Okay, so I was trying to think, as a worldly parent versus a Christian parent.
Right.
So obviously Christian parents would not accept that, or should not accept that. But you have to understand that the Bible verse that says, God is the branch, we are the vine, right? So the parent as the branch produces that vine. So whatever their standards are, they're gonna portray that to the child, right? So if to them they're open-minded and they accept certain things, I don't want to deny my kid of anything good, then they'll allow it. But the Bible also says that if God doesn't correct you, you're not a son but a bastard. So for a parent not to correct their child, they're actually kind of like disowning their child and their God-given parental role. So it's really damaging. And there's a lot that goes into that, but that's
just
my thought.
Just to add on to what our sister was saying, it reminds me what Christ says, as many as I love, I rebuke and chasten.
Amen.
So right. they should be corrected. And I believe there's a text in Proverbs that says, faithful are the wounds of a friend, but deceitful are the kisses of an enemy.
Mercy. Mm.
So if we're not giving this faithful reproof to our children, correcting them, and we're sparing the rod,
right,
and we're not correcting them, and we truly don't love them.
Mm-hmm.
Exactly.
We truly don't love them.
Exactly. Right.
And I'm sorry to cut you off.
Okay.
And what's very important is that many parents may find themselves at the tail end of the situation saying, oh no, why would you go this way? What
right.
are you doing, right?
Mm-hmm.
However, what many parents and people don't do is realize, have I been setting the standard in the first place?
Mm-hmm.
Because if you're not setting the standard, you're not teaching your child, training them up as they go, right?
Mm-hmm.
Me personally, if I didn't tell my son, hey, this is wrong, I'd be less inclined to censure them because they didn't know,
mm-hmm.
right? So I will make sure that from the very beginning, I'm teaching my child, training
goes
them
back
up.
To Deuteronomy.
Exactly. Yeah. And then when it happens, they're like, okay, my father is, let's say you don't spare the rod, you spank them, right?
Right.
Right? There's an understanding,
mm-hmm.
but there's a lack of understanding where you as a parent fail to teach the principles of the word.
Right.
And then try to chastise your child after the fact when you never taught them in the first place, right?
And it also reminds me, going back to the point we were saying with the parents, specifically the dad in this instance, it reminds me of Aaron's sons and even Eli's sons.
Mm.
They were not correcting their children. They were not giving them reproof. And look what abominations they brought into the sanctuary, or even the death of Aaron's sons, bringing the strange fire.
Mercy.
They had their own style of worship, bringing this strange doctrine into the house of God.
Mm-hmm.
So if individually or collectively as families, if we are not correcting or educating our home or setting it in order, this will reflect and will pass on even in the church.
Right.
And that's what we don't want, because now the church at large will be in a fallen state. And that's why we have to be, it begins in the home, and this goes back to the message of Elijah in Malachi chapter 4, you know, turning the hearts. God says he'll send Elijah before the coming of the Lord, turning the hearts from the sons to the fathers and the fathers to the sons. So it has to begin in the home, then it can expand even globally, that this gospel may even be preached. And it begins with the example that we're setting and the teaching that we're given.
Now, I know, some people who might be watching don't know or don't believe the same things we believe or don't understand things the way that we have come to understand them through the Word of God, right? And the Spirit of Prophecy. So my question is, should boys wear women's clothing and why shouldn't they?
Leviticus. I mean, if I could find it, but women shouldn't wear men's clothing and men shouldn't wear women's clothing. It's an abomination to the Lord. And I've had this conversation before, and some people say, oh, but back in the day, women's clothes and men's clothes then were different than women's clothes and men's clothes today. But so I would say anything that you know in your society that is deemed men's apparel or deems women's apparel, don't cross it.
Amen. Any thoughts, Brian?
I believe there's even if someone was to bring up that example, there's still, I believe there are still distinct differences, even in the time of Christ, back in the day that you would know a man from a woman.
Yeah.
Personally, I think I agree with you guys. I don't think a man should be wearing what pertains to a woman or a woman to a man, because that's confusion. That's
right.
That's an abomination in the sight of God, we're told. And we shouldn't, we definitely shouldn't be allowed
to wear a dress or a skirt if you're a young man, and
no,
if you're a woman,
not
to wear the things
nope.
that pertain to a man.
Right.
Absolutely not. So, you know, it's interesting because we see these things. These are two shows that are, this stuff is fairly new, right?
Yeah.
New in Blue's Clues, new in the Muppet Baby Show, right? Now, sometimes we might think, oh, okay, well, TV is not the same anymore.
Yep.
It's nothing like what we used to watch.
Yeah.
Right? But I want us to be careful, right? Even you watching. I want us to be careful, because what we're going to do today is revisit our childhood. look at the shows in the past that we liked a lot, right? And to see whether or not they're as innocent as we think they were, right? Let's go ahead, and we're going to start with a show you guys may or may not know. It's called Rocko's Modern Life, right? Rocko's Modern Life. You're familiar with it, Brian?
I think I've seen it or heard about it.
So the scene we're about to watch is that Rocko finds a new job. And he finds a new job, and I want you to see the video, analyze the video, and to let me know what you notice from it, because I'm going to tell you what I notice from it. Remember, this is a kid's show on Nickelodeon.
Oh, baby, oh, baby, oh, baby. Rocko? Mrs. Bighead?
You may not have noticed stuff, right? But I just want to let you know what he did. He went on the phone, said, oh, baby, oh, baby, oh, baby. His neighbor picked up the phone, and she's shocked that it's him, right? Mm-hmm. This is a new job he got, right? So
I saw the sign.
You saw the sign on the wall?
Yeah.
Which one? The red one or the?
The white one.
The white one, okay? Right. Let's look at that sign again, right? Let's look at it again.
Oh, baby, oh, baby, oh, baby. Rocko.
It says, remember, be hot, be naughty.
Be courteous.
Be courteous. Be hot, be naughty, be courteous. He's on a phone line, on a hotline.
Interesting.
Right? Mm-hmm. Saying those things with his neighbor on the phone. Mm-hmm. It says to be naughty. What do you think there were a hidden message that they were hiding in this video for kids? If you don't have the answer, I'll tell you.
Go ahead.
Well, oh, obviously they're prostituting. He's prostituting himself.
Absolutely. Absolutely. That is imitating a phone sex line.
Oh.
A phone sex line. That's why he's saying, oh, baby. Oh, baby.
Like, those things are real? Like, in the world?
Those things are real in the world, unfortunately.
And even if you looked at the beginning of the video, it said specialty phone call or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
So it kind of, and then if you read, you can tell he's in a workplace. And then when you see that sign, it's like the instructions he's supposed to, or the way he's supposed to, you
and
know,
this is a children's cartoon.
On Nickelodeon.
Huh.
Nickelodeon. Okay. Imagine your kids watching it and watching a show, and then you see somebody working in a phone sex hotline saying,
I don't think they would get it.
They wouldn't get it.
So it's like planting seeds. Mm-hmm. They don't get it now until they're older. They produce the fruits. Mm-hmm. So I don't think they would pick up on it.
Now, do you guys remember stuff like this when you were kids?
No.
No. Yeah, there was this one cartoon. Mm-hmm. I think we spoke about it.
Which one?
I forgot the name, but it was something. It was a very crazy old cartoon. I think there were two dogs. You know which one I'm talking about, or no?
Ren and Stimpy.
That's it.
Yes.
I think that's the one.
That one thing was bad.
Yes. And I remember when I was little, I've seen it a couple of times, and even as a little kid, I knew that something was wrong here.
Mm-hmm. Oh, wow.
Yeah, because it was bad. Yep.
Oh. You see, parents say, not parents, but everybody says, oh, Disney's bad. Listen, majority of these shows are bad. And this is our childhood. We don't remember these things, but I'm going to show you guys online and show us how many sexual innuendos and inappropriate content have been in kids' shows. And there's a very popular kids' show that I'm about to show you that we all know of. And we all probably remember this scene. Right? So let's see a scene from SpongeBob SquarePants.
Gary! I was just looking for the sports channel, Gary. Come in!
Okay. So what do you think was going on in this scene?
I mean, because of his reaction, it was something wrong, but I mean, wasn't it just like a barnacle or something?
Any thoughts, Brian?
Well, it was is teaching the children to hide things that are inappropriate. He was
right.
Definitely watching something inappropriate, because as soon as Gary came in, I gotta hide this now. I gotta flip. I don't want him to find out.
Exactly. And do you know anybody that struggles with pornography?
Not personally.
I believe there's a lot of young people that do. Personally, when I, work in ministry, I do see a lot of young men deal with it. Mm-hmm. Personally, it is, I think it's prevalent among the young people.
Very
personally.
Prevalent. Yes.
And I believe it even, we can even tie this back to the count of Lot. Mm-hmm. Because a lot of these sins, if we go to, I believe it's Ezekiel. Let me just confirm this. Yes, Ezekiel 16:49. Ezekiel 16:49. It tells us, "Behold, this was the iniquity of thy sister Sodom, pride, fullness of bread." So their intemperance and abundance of idleness. Their idol was in her and in her daughters. Neither did she strengthen the hand of the poor and needy. And we know Sodom was known for a lot of sexual sins. Sodom.
Absolutely.
And it, see, here we see that the root of it was, again, indulgence and idleness. Mm-hmm. So I think when if there is a young person who is dealing with pornography, they should be obviously fasting and praying, have temperance, because, you know, us as Adventists, we have a health message. And the health message, you know, without having a whole study here, but the health message connects right with our spirituality.
Right.
So it starts back with the health. And if we have, if we're temperate, even as the Apostle Paul says, they that strive for the mastery is temperate in all things. So if we're temperate, and we're fasting and praying, and we're spending time with Christ, we shouldn't be dealing with these sins or issues, or we should be overcoming by God's grace.
Yeah.
For Christ tells us that He's able to keep us from falling. That's Jude chapter 1, verse 24.
Mm-hmm.
Sister, yeah. You're going to say.
I think idleness is a key word.
Key word. Yeah,
yeah, because there's a Jamaican proverb that says, the devil finds works for idle hands.
Mm-hmm.
So because they're idle, the devil gives them something to do, which is to watch those things. And also with these cartoons and the subliminal messages, as we're talking about, it goes over their head like a kid, but it plants a seed there, so it makes them more prone to gravitate towards those things because it's in their subconscious, but they don't know it's there.
See, you guys are
so
actually,
it appeals to them.
You guys are actually hitting the questions I was going to ask.
Oh,
but you know, the question was, do you think that something like this, because let me state the fact, this is normalizing pornography and being sneaky about it as well.
Right.
It's obvious SpongeBob was watching a pornographic show, right? And as Gary walked in, he got scared and he sought to change the channel, right? It's being normalized, right? So do you think that small seeds like this possibly have aided some people's porn addictions that we know today?
Definitely.
Well, I would say it reminds me of the scripture where it says, "For God is not mocked. Whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap." So here we see that this they're sowing into children that it's okay to do this, just hide it. And now we're seeing it more blatantly open with the whole of the previous videos with the whole gay agenda. So they are definitely sowing seeds, and I do believe that if we're allowing our children to watch these things, they're going to reap a harvest at the end of the day.
Right.
And
yes.
I think, I'm trying to look for it, but I think John 3:18, if I'm not mistaken, or somewhere in John it says, "By beholding you become changed." So by beholding these cartoons over time, your heart, your thoughts, becomes changed towards these things.
I believe it's in Corinthians that as we look into a glass, as we behold. But so I want to show you this next clip, and then a clip right after that one, and then we'll talk about it, right?
Okay.
So this next one is Johnny Bravo. A lot of us knew about Johnny Bravo. We watched Johnny Bravo when we were younger. This show is geared to teenagers. However, that doesn't matter. Whether you're a teenager, whether you're a kid, even if you're an adult, it's not appropriate, right? Let's see what this scene, what's going on in this scene, and let's analyze it.
You idiot! That was a priceless Ming vase. I mean, why don't you come sit on the sofa while I slip into something more comfortable?
Mm-hmm. That zirconium in your stomach will more than make up for it.
Okay, so when I look at this scene, mm-hmm. immediately I'm asking myself, what is she changing her clothes for to get more comfortable for? Mm-hmm. What kind of sexual mm-hmm. innuendo, what kind of sexual messaging is that sending to young teens mm-hmm. when they watch something like this? But we're going to continue and watch another scene, and we'll talk about both, right? Let's watch this next scene. This is about Johnny Bravo.
Did you see a gorilla run by here?
No.
Did you see a gorilla run by here?
No.
Did you see a...
gorilla?
So I was wondering, you wouldn't happen to be hiding any gorillas underneath them clothes, would you? She wants me.
Okay, so when we look at these two clips, what we know about Johnny Bravo is that Johnny is often trying to pick up women mm-hmm. and always making sexual innuendos, right? Mm-hmm. So I personally believe it also is encouraging young men to engage in what's called pickup culture, right? So should young boys get comfortable in approaching women in the certain ways that he does? What are you guys' thoughts on this whole scene? This scene and the scene before. Yeah.
Well, it takes me to Genesis chapter 6.
Mm-hmm. Genesis 6?
Yeah. And here we see an example of what this man is doing. Now, obviously, I wouldn't say he's a son of God, but in Genesis chapter 6, and actually, we would even begin at, we'll start at verse 2. It says, "The sons of God saw the daughters of men, that they were fair, and they took them wives of all which they chose." And how does God feel about this? "And the Lord said, My spirit shall not always strive with man, for that he also is flesh, yet his days shall be 120 years. So here we see that, which we would recall as pickup culture mm-hmm. among church brethren, which this is not the way that God has ordained, because in the garden, did Adam go out looking for Eve?
No.
What about Rebekah and Isaac?
Oh, his father was involved.
Right, his father was involved. And then when the father saw that it was the right time for him to have a wife, then he sent forth his servant, and the servant went forth and brought the wife mm-hmm. unto Isaac. So here we see that to be chasing after females, or to be in this pickup culture, as it were, is not the way of God at the end of the day. And many people nowadays, especially young people, mm-hmm. they church hop. They looking for wives or mm-hmm. looking for husbands. And that's not the way, because now they're matchmaking, or it reminds me of a quote in the Spirit of Proverbs. It says, many are mated but not matched.
Right.
And then we're told, who can find a virtuous woman? Mm-hmm. And we know only God can. So if a young man is doing what he's supposed to, and if it's God's will for him, God will bring the woman in his life when it is the right time, even mm-hmm. as we saw Abraham chose the appointed time. Mm-hmm. Abraham being a type of God the Father.
Absolutely.
Right, and then the servant spoke not of himself, he spoke about the Father and the Son. Mm-hmm. So it's even a type of the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost, God will bring two people together. Mm-hmm. There's no need to be chasing females, as we see Johnny.
Amen.
No
Thank
chasing.
You for that sermon,
Brian. Amen.
I'm going to do the flip side. So the female.
I'm glad you're doing that, because I'm going to do that
yeah.
too.
So growing up, I did not like watching Johnny Bravo. I thought he was one of the dumbest cartoons out there.
Amen.
I really didn't
Amen.
Like watching him. But in the first video, you can see where it's teaching or allowing girls to think that they can subdue or use their bodies to
seduce
mm-hmm. men. And there is a Bible verse, I think in Proverbs, that says that she calls them into her house, and they don't know that it's a house full with bones and dead men.
Don't even walk past her house.
Yeah. Exactly.
Proverbs 7, I think it is.
Mm-hmm. Right. And then the other one with the lady, that he came back. He was looking for a girl, mm-hmm. and then he came back because mm-hmm. he realized, oh, that was a lady. So it doesn't matter who it is. Once it's a female, that's it. And it shows us that when men approach us like this, we have to be really defensive. If you realize they're very violent towards him,
right.
they pepper spray him, they tase him, they throw him all
Which
over the place.
Which is also not the way to go about it, too.
Right.
Yeah.
But in accordance with what Brian was saying about God finding someone for you, Matthew 6:33, But seek ye first the kingdom of God, and all these things will be added unto you. And also, I think in Romans, Paul was saying that he wished that everyone was like him, like him. You know, mm-hmm. where, because marriage comes with an additional responsibility. And a lot of people, or even young people, they don't accept the fact that it's not God's will for everyone to be married. Mm-hmm. And you have to find the time to ask God to see if that is his will for you.
Amen. Mm-hmm. Amen. And just to go on with what you were saying, Brian.
I have something to say, too.
Oh, awesome. Let's hear what you guys say.
No, go ahead.
Sure. Just to go along with what you say, you know, many times we try to work ahead of God.
Right.
Right? But God set it up that, of course, our parents are watching over us. And right. just like what you were mentioning when it comes to young women, but we know in today's society, a lot of young women, they always say, oh, they hate men or men are trash, right? Mm-hmm. But what we often see is that we have a lot of young women making bad choices, mm-hmm. right? And one of the main issues is that they're going around trying to move ahead of God, making their own choices mm-hmm. when their parents should be the ones guiding and vetting mm-hmm. the young men that they bring into their lives. So mm-hmm. even a show like this mm-hmm. might be promoting for young men, and many other shows, not even only cartoons. Mm-hmm. Just in our society, the pickup culture and the culture of dating, right? It's so polluted and so perverted that there's no wonder why there's an issue with marriage in society today. Because mm-hmm. many of people are not following God's standard of how to find a mate. Brian.
Yes, so it reminds me even the children of Israel, when they're about to enter the promised land, Satan brought harlots to throw them off. Mm-hmm. So he uses lust, and we see that being portrayed on shows, movies, media. And then there was something else you said. Yes. Another example that comes to my mind is even the account of Dinah. I believe that's Genesis 34. And Dinah, she was with this, or she was defiled because she went out to hang out with the daughters of the world, you know, the daughters of men. So she placed herself in a place where she wasn't supposed to be to begin with. And then that led her to being defiled by another man. I believe it was Shechem, if I'm not mistaken. And what does this man do? He goes and tries to have her as a wife. Now, being a heathen man, he might have several wives. Mm. But he's told that, hey, you must be circumcised if you were to marry an Israelite. And then circumcision for the Jew is even as baptism for the Christian. So now many people today, they'll quote unquote, be converted so I could be with this person.
Right.
So even the Bible shows that this is not right. Mm-hmm. There's examples even in the Bible. And you know, conversion should be a sincere love and surrender for Christ, not because you want to be with this person, because that's not a true conversion.
Amen.
Anyone could get splashed in some water and come out. Are they a different person?
No.
No, the change has to begin in the heart prior, and then it can go forward.
Amen. You're not yoked together with unbelievers.
Amen. Amen. And that's what happens when we don't allow God to lead, and also when we allow the principles and the influences from different syndicated shows, TV shows, kids' cartoons, to influence us and teach us, oh, right. This is how I'm supposed to approach life. This is how I'm supposed to have a mate, find someone to marry.
So yes. So I've learned there, I had this discussion with some young people, and we figured out that young women, especially when they reach 25, it becomes a hurry. So there was another couple there that she was sharing some experiences that she had with other young women. And this one specific young lady, she was like, if I turn 25 and I don't have a husband, I'm going to go out and search for him herself because she's like, God's taking too long.
Wow.
Because by 30, she needs to be married, have her life, children, and biological clock. We tend to use that as females. And even now, this dating has become so polluted, as you were saying, that they create shows like Love is Blind on Netflix. Most young people know that. Mm-hmm. Because they're saying that the dating apps aren't working, because people aren't genuine anymore, and whatever they're looking for, it's not out there. It's so hard to find because, as we're saying, they're not following the biblical principles. But when they do go on these shows to be like, oh yes, I'm going to find the perfect person, it still doesn't work out. Because how can you marry someone in a month?
Yeah.
And say you love them, you know? So a hard conversion and seeking first the kingdom of God is the first way to go.
It even reminds me of Solomon with his wives, heathen wives, how it took him away from Christ and the ministry. And we're told in the law, I believe it's Deuteronomy 22, if I'm not mistaken, we're told that thou shalt not yoke an ox with an ass. So these, it has to be equally yoked, ox with ox, because ox is a working animal that works the field, and an ass is an animal that is stubborn. So as Christians, we're to be yoked up with the one whom God has brought unto us, or if we're talking about in a church sense, with the institution or the organization which God is placing us, that is following the right order, so we could be working the field.
And as the Spirit of Prophecy said, a lot of marriages are tied up in your eternal salvation, and it can cause you to be lost or saved, so it's a very serious decision.
It could greatly ruin your influence, ruin your usefulness.
Right.
Is what Ellen White says. Now, so just to, I guess, give credit, for lack of better words, to the show, it does a good job of saying what Johnny Bravo is doing is incorrect.
Okay.
Right?
Right. True.
However, there's a trope hidden in the show that we often see about Johnny Bravo. Can anybody guess what that is? Not just Johnny Bravo, but men in general. Can anybody guess what that might be?
That is an idiot.
That he's an
idiot.
That
was my first thought of him.
That he's dumb.
Yeah.
Right? And oftentimes we often get this idea and trope that men are dumb, right? When we watch these shows, right? So that's why we're gonna go to our next video. This is from a show called Gumball. Gumball. And we're gonna watch, and it's about Gumball's father. And once again, we're talking about how fathers are portrayed on television.
What's going on?
I think he's using his brain.
This is dangerous. He's pushing way past his usual limits.
I got it.
Dad, what'd you do with the money?
Well, I did what all the business sharks do to avoid getting taxed. I transferred it to an offshore bank account.
Richard, what exactly have you done with my money?
Like I said, I put it offshore. But not before converting it into gold.
Just off the bat, what are you guys' thoughts on this, these clips, and what do you think it's saying about fathers?
I was trying not to laugh because all of that, just to put one synapse together, that was actually ridiculous. But it's saying that, and it's so sad because men are supposed to be the priests and like the leaders of the home, and throughout society, there's a lot of deadbeat dads out there, and it's kind of normalized now. And the most successful people in this world, they always give a shout out to their mom for being strong and be there, and dads are heavily looked down on.
Even on Father's Day, you have a lot of mothers saying, say it to me.
Yep.
I'm the father now, right?
Yep.
They want a lot of single mothers, mainly, are hijacking Father's Day and saying, oh no, give us the glory on that day.
What's interesting is, in connection to that, if you notice the cartoon, the mother was blue and he was pink.
Mercy.
Oh,
exactly what you were saying. And then she had like an LGB or some type of color thing.
A rainbow thing, yeah.
Yeah, I don't know if that was what it's supposed to be, but to me it looked that way. So it's confusion.
Yeah.
And then, you know, it's like what our sister said, they're portraying the father as someone who's dumb. Mm-hmm. He doesn't know anything. Mm-hmm. And how will they now think of God, the Heavenly Father?
That's true.
And then as she was saying, you know, Ephesians 5:25, the husband or the man is supposed to be the priest, like unto Christ, and Christ is the priest, according to Hebrews chapter 9. And then we're also told in Malachi chapter 2 that the priest is supposed to have the law, the word of God, in their mouth. So now if we're seeing fathers being portrayed as dumb or idiots or whatever, are the children really going to take him serious when he brings out the word of God?
Exactly. And you touched on the last question in this segment, but that's
okay.
No, it's great though. But exactly. And this is not exclusive to just this show, Gumball. Mm-hmm. We see it in almost all cartoons, and not only cartoons. We see this in TV shows, even TV shows for adults. Mm-hmm. The Simpsons, Family Guy. The father is a dumb idiot, mm-hmm. right? And the mother is the one who's more wise, the one who knows best, right? Mm-hmm. Even in this video, we see the mother's like, hey, what you do with my money? Mm-hmm. Where is my money? And he said, oh, I... Whatever he said, he threw it in the water, right? Displaying him as an idiot and the mother as one who is more superior, one who is wiser. So how do you think these kind of ideas would affect society and children growing up today?
Well, I want to state something here.
Yeah.
Because that's a very interesting thing you brought up, how there's putting the mother as someone wiser than the father. Mm-hmm. And I'm not saying that the mother shouldn't be wise. Obviously,
right.
She used to be wise. And, the virtuous woman. Mm-hmm. But the reason why this is also a danger, the way they're portraying it, is because we're told in Revelation that the papacy, Babylon, is making drunk all of the nations. Mm-hmm. And the church, or Babylon, is likened unto a woman. And she is placing herself above God, even God the Father. So even spiritually speaking, what they're portraying is even the wine of Babylon, teaching them that the woman is above, even like in the church, is above God, even the word of God. Because again, the papacy thinketh to change times and laws, mm-hmm. able to change the word of God as she pleases,
yeah.
which is not true.
Mercy. Jodian.
So I have a few thoughts. So the first one is Isaiah 1 verse 5. The part that says the whole head is sick and the whole heart faints. So as we were already establishing that the father is supposed to be the head of the house, the priest. So if the father is look at this idiot or so, he doesn't have the capacity to be responsible, then the entire family is shaken from there, and then the priesthood would then be transferred to the mom. And for the kids in the cartoon are to see that, they look at their mom as the more responsible one and will gravitate towards anything important, they go to mommy, mommy, mommy. And then I wanted also to point out something else that I think Brian said about, I'm losing my train of thought. What did you think?
About the woman.
Okay, I lost it.
No problem. Anything else, Brian?
No.
Okay. So now it's very sad that we have this in kids' cartoons. I knew as me growing up seeing that. Now I'm older, I'm like, whoa. Mm-hmm. Literally, almost every show, Malcolm in the Middle, all of these shows are showing that the father is dumb, mm-hmm. right? And the father sometimes is also subservient to the mother. Mm-hmm. How could something like this affect our idea of our heavenly father?
I think that was what I was going to say. Mm-hmm. I was going to say the lack of soulness or the lack of how the kids look at their father, their father can't even rebuke them because they will see it as a joke or they won't take it as seriously. And you know that the family structure is supposed to represent the heavenly structure. So just like how the father doesn't really have that impact on the kids because they see him as less than, they will not see Jesus in that same capacity because Jesus is supposed to represent our Father, to rebuke us, to reprove us. And if their earthly father isn't imaging that, then to give them the gospel and to tell them that, hey, this is who Jesus is as a father, it will be hard for them to accept. Mm-hmm. And they won't even trust their father because how we relate to our parents is kind of a similitude of how we relate to God.
Amen.
And if you can't trust your earthly father, then it will be really difficult for you to trust a God that you can't see who's supposed to be your father.
Amen.
Yes, I agree. And then, now I don't see anything wrong with the father being having servitude towards the wife. Mm. Because again, Ephesians 5, it says, husbands love the wives, even as Christ loved the church. Mm. And we saw Christ came to serve, not to be served. You know, he was serving. And Christ even says that the servant is the greatest. When he was asked, who shall be the greatest? The servant is the greatest.
The best leaders are those who serve.
Right. So I think in that sense, it's not entirely wrong. But now when you're portraying them, the father, as one who doesn't know better.
Someone you can't rely on.
Right, and it reminds me even of the subtlety of Satan, giving the fruit of knowledge of good and evil to the wife, and now the wife is bringing it to the husband, mm-hmm. as if she knew better, mm-hmm. which she was deceived, and the husband was not. So again, she was, we're told in Adventist home, and I think even patriarchs and prophets, that Eve tried to raise above a sphere higher than where mm-hmm. God has placed her, like modern day Eve's, mm-hmm. and fell way below it.
Before I lose my train of thought again, yes. So we can see where the roles are flipped. Mm-hmm. Satan loves to do that, where it's either the wife is superior to the husband, or even the LGBT, where roles are switched. Mm-hmm. And even sometimes the kids are ruling their parents, mm-hmm. because when they see cartoons that have bad behaving children and the parents, they don't get any punishment for them. But oh yeah, I can act like that. So there's a lot of role switching, mm-hmm. and even with the dressing, there's a lot of confusion within the family circle. Mm-hmm.
And you ever go to the grocery store or somewhere public, and you just see a young child, and the parent is telling them, "Oh, be quiet, mm-hmm. Timmy," and the child is yelling and cursing at their parents, mm-hmm. right? Where do they get these things from, right? When principles on TV and the things that we watch are full of violence and backwards principles, mm-hmm. right, of honoring your parents, even honoring your father, and even honoring your mother. Mm-hmm. What you allow your child to consume mentally, mm-hmm. at home is going to lead to things that are not of God if the things that they consume are not from the bread of life.
And Jeff, even lead them to destruction. It reminds me even the account of Elijah, mm-hmm. when he was walking, the two children, the two young lads came and called him, "Hey, bald head."
Yeah.
And what happened?
They were mauled by a bear. Yeah.
And where did this begin? In the home. Mm-hmm. They're irreverent. They didn't have respect for the man of God.
Amen. Amen. So what we're going to do now is we're going to go through a collage of different videos, right?
Okay.
And we're going to look at them. We can talk about them. And then we're just going to close out. We're coming to a close, all right? Mm-hmm. So let's watch. This is from a few shows. You have SpongeBob. You have just a couple of other ones, all right? Let's take a look.
I can't seem to get happy. Maybe this will help.
Honey, I don't think that's going to fit.
Just a little more, dear. Got it. See, hon? I told you I could do it.
All right, Grunkle Stan, where did you hide that card? Nothing? 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 Ew. Pretending I never saw that?
What's the big deal? You had some nightmares.
These weren't just dreams. They felt like they really happened.
I don't know. I've had some dreams that felt mighty real. There was this one the other night.
I'm sick of the mall. How about a ride?
You like that car more than me.
Who's talking about cars?
Yeah, this room is way creepy.
Not as creepy as Dipper's internet history. Hey-o!
Okay, so we saw this. We saw in SpongeBob, Squidward, they were alluding to him committing suicide by hanging himself. We have one show from that. I don't know the name of the show, but the kid who opened the chest. Yeah.
Gravity Falls.
He mm-hmm. opens the chest, imitating as if he saw some pornographic magazines in the chest. We saw a few things from what was that? Batman Beyond, from Justice League. Mm-hmm. What are your guys' thoughts on what you just saw?
Very subtle.
It really is.
And I honestly, I've seen some of those shows. Obviously, SpongeBob, but most of us seen. I've seen the Justice League. Growing up, I used to watch that a lot, and I didn't pick up on that until now that I see. I'm like, oh wow, that is crazy. Mm-hmm.
And while I was reviewing some of these videos, I saw some other Justice League shots with that guy, Green Arrow. Mm-hmm. I mean, we know these because we remember them from our past. Mm-hmm. The superhero Green Arrow looking at the Lady Canary. There's mm-hmm. another scene where they're about to, they're fighting, hitting punching bags, right? And she's like, oh, do you want to take a round with me? And it's very subtle, but it's very sexual. She's like, no, I'm talking about fighting, right? Mm-hmm. So it's very sexual, very in your face, mm-hmm. very subtle. And us as kids, we watch these shows, and sometimes we have so much nostalgia. We get together, and we're like, oh, hey, you remember this show? Oh, yeah, I love this show. Not realizing that these shows in the past had a lot of subliminal messages and a lot of straightforward messages. that are not appropriate. And some people say, oh, when it comes to these shows, oh, it's okay because they put some jokes in there that the parents will know, but the kids won't understand, but so the parents can enjoy it too. But listen, it's not good for the parents either, that one.
Right?
And it's subliminal going into the child's mind. And I know there are some jokes that in my life that I've noticed, some jokes, some funny things here and there, some mannerisms that I know that came from cartoons in the past. And a lot of these, some of these things are not appropriate as I look at them in retrospect. Any other thoughts or comments?
So there's this article on the effect of cartoons on children's behavior and mental state. It's mostly talking about violence, but we can also allude to the sexual part that we were talking about. So it says, cartoons normalize violence and make it seem common and acceptable. Repetitive, unpunished, and realistic violence or behaviors like this is likely to be mimicked by the child.
There
you go. Violent cartoons can lead to disobedience, nervous, and aggressive tendencies, and it desensitizes children to sorrow, pain, and violence. So it encourages violence, promotes unruly behavior, lack of empathy, promotes the use of foul language, unsocial behavior, and even mental problems.
Mercy.
Yep.
Brian?
It reminds me of a text, Exodus 34, in regards to children being educated. And obviously, if the parents are allowing them to watch this, they see no problem with it.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. And in Exodus 34, it says, keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin, and that will by no means clear the guilty, visiting the iniquities of the fathers upon the children and upon the children's children unto the third and the fourth generation. Now, why is he visiting the father's iniquities to the children? Well, because the children are practicing or learning from the father and committing the same sins. And thus, it is a generational curse, as it were, or it's passed down these sins, these influences, these habits. And thus, God will visit them, even in judgment.
Right. Amen. Did you have something, Jordana?
Just the last scripture, John, 3 John, chapter 1, verse 4. I have no greater joy than to hear that my children walk in the truth. So as we can see, like, parents have a huge responsibility to teach their kids the truth. Because as we established earlier, children are like a blank slate. You got to teach them what's right and what's wrong. And we see when we deviate from what we're supposed to train them up to do, the fruits that they produce are these unhealthy practices.
Amen. And that's why we should keep thy heart with all diligence, for out of it
are the issues,
the issues of life.
Wow. So I want to bring out this, just our final quotation. I think this is very potent to this subject, and it's from Acts of the Apostles, page 518, paragraph 2. It says, the apostles sought to teach the believers how important it is to what?
Keep in mind.
Keep the mind from wandering to forbidden themes, or from spending its energies on what?
Trifling subjects.
Trifling subjects. Those who would not fall a prey to Satan's devices must guard well the avenues of the soul. They must avoid reading, seeing, or hearing. Someone might say, oh, well, what if I just read it? How? It has no effect on me. It says, reading, seeing, or hearing, that will suggest what?
Impure thoughts.
The mind must not be left to dwell at random upon every subject that the enemy of souls may suggest. The heart must be faithfully sentineled, or evils without will awaken evils from where?
Within.
From evils within. So yes, we all have sinful natures, right? Right? Born in sin, right? Shaping in iniquity, right? But when we watch things, as we're trying to be Christian, we're trying to be more like Christ by God's power, not by strength, but by God's power, right? When we're trying to do these things by faith, right? But we watch these evil things, they awaken the evils within. The evils from without awaken the evil from within. And I'll continue. And the soul will wander in darkness. And it ends with, gird up the loins of your mind. Any thoughts?
Amen. The first thing that came to me was Matthew 6, verse 13, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. So, and we know that the battle itself is the greatest battle that we'll ever fight. And we know that a lot of people misinterpret that to say that God can tempt us, but we know that we are drawn away by the lust that of our minds and lust of ourselves. So when we pray, deliver us from temptation, it's the temptations within and the temptations without.
Amen, amen. Brian, were you about to say something?
No.
Okay, no problem. So everyone, thank you so much for joining us with our rap session. As you see, this was unscripted. We just went with it, praise God. And if you want to join along in the rap session to be a part of the panel, give us a call. You'll see the number on the screen as well. But please like, rate, comment down below, and let us know your thoughts on some of these childhood cartoons. Let us know your experience. And we'll see you next time.